question.
Yes, can you tell me what you know about risks to the therapist? What kind of
data... You would have to ask.
Yeah, I'd like to know that. What kind of data do you have, given that you've had contact with large numbers of people? Not just threats, but also any injury, any family problems that have arisen? That's one question. The second one is, are you aware of anybody that you've treated or others with this level of dissociation and trauma that have recovered, integrated, whole, and happy?
I have one non-bloodline multiple, complex multiple, who have this kind of programming where they have a lot of access to the patient as neighbors and with a doctor. By the way, you'll find physicians heavily involved. They've encouraged their own to go to medical school, to prescribe drugs, to take care of their own, to get access to medical technology and be above suspicion. There have been a couple, in fact, in Utah who have been nailed now. We now in Utah have two full-time ritual abuse investigators with statewide jurisdiction under the Attorney General's office to do nothing but investigate this. Okay? And in a poll done in the state of Utah in January by the major newspaper and television station, they found that 90% of Utahns believe that ritual abuse is genuine and real. Not all of them believe it's a frequent occurrence, but some of that in part from 2 years of work by the Governor's Commission on Ritual Abuse, interviewing, talking, meeting people, gathering data. And when people say, by the way, there's no evidence, they've never found a body, that's baloney. They found a body in Idaho of a child. They've had a case last summer that was convicted on first-degree murder charges, two people that the summer before that were arrested, where the teenage girl's finger and head were in the refrigerator. They were convicted of first-degree murder in Detroit. There have been cases and bodies. Back to risk. I know of no therapist who's been harmed.
Proceed.
Inform us that there will come a future time where we could be at risk of being assassinated by parts of patients who have been programmed to kill at a certain time. Anyone that they've told and any member of their own family who's not active. If that would come about, is
speculative.
Who knows, for sure, maybe. But I don't think it's entirely without risk. Question in the back.
I don't know.
if anybody else has found anything associated with that or not. Yes?
What's the difference between this kind of program and cult-type abuse and satanic abuse and the kind of cults with the candles and the kind of
This type of programming will be done in the cults with candles and all of the rest. My impression is this is simply done in people where they have great access to them, or their bloodline and their parents are in it, where they can be raised in it from an early age. If they are bloodline, they are the chosen generation. If not, they are expendable, and they are expected to die and not get well. And there will be booby traps in your way if they're non-bloodline people, that when they get well, they will kill themselves. And I'll tell you just a little about that. But my belief is that some people that have ritual abuse and don't have this have been ritually abused, but they may be part of a non-mainstream group. The Satanism comes in the overall philosophy overriding all of this. People say, what's the purpose of it? My best guess is that the purpose of it is that they want an army of Manchurian candidates. Tens of thousands of mental robots who will do prostitution, do child pornography, smuggle drugs, engage in international arms smuggling, do snuff films, all sorts of very lucrative things, and do their bidding. And eventually, the megalomaniacs at the top believe create a satanic order that will rule the world. One last question, then I'll give you a couple more details and we need to shift gears.
You have suggested or implied that at some point, at a high level of the U.S. government, there was support for this kind of thing. I know we're short of time, but can you just say a few words about the kind of documentation that may exist for that suggestion?
There isn't great documentation of it. It comes from victims who are imperiled witnesses. The interesting thing is how many people have described the same scenario and how many people that we have worked with who have had relatives in NASA, in the CIA, and in the military, including very high ups in the military. I can tell you that a friend and colleague of mine who has probably the equivalent of half the table space on that far side of the room filled with boxes with declassified documents from mind control research done in the past that has been able to be declassified over a considerable, a couple of decade period, and has read more government documents about mind control than anyone else, has a brief that has literally been sent in the past week and a half asking for all information to be declassified about the Monarch Project, for us to try and find out more. Now, let me just mention something about some of the stuff that you will, my experience is in several patients now that you may run into late in the process. I know I'm throwing a lot at you in a hurry. Some of it is completely foreign, and some of you may think, gosh, could any of this be true? Just, you know, ask. Find out in your patients, and you may be lucky, and there isn't any of this. Somewhere at a deep level, you may run onto some things like this. Let me describe to you, I can find my pen, the system in one patient. One patient I had treated for quite a while, a non-bloodline person, and we had done what appeared to be successful work and reached final integration. And she came back to me early last year and said she was symptomatic with some things. I started inquiring. I found a part there. We'd integrated. The part basically said there was other stuff that I couldn't tell you about, and you integrated me, and so I had to split off. I'd done some inquiring about things like alpha beta as a routine part of it and found they were there. And I said to this part, why didn't you tell me about this stuff? And she said, well, we gave you some hints, but they went right over your head. I said, sorry. Well, we knew that you didn't know enough to help us.
But now we know you can. And so stuff started coming out. It was interesting. She described the overall system, if I can remember it now, as being like this. The circle represented harm to the body. A system of alters whose primary purpose was to hurt her, including symptoms like Munchausen's, self-mutilation, other kinds of things. Each of the triangles represented still another, different system. She said, with the exception of me, this one part, you dealt with the whole circle with the work that we did before, but you didn't touch the rest of the stuff. Okay. In the middle of all this was still another system consisting of the Kabbalistic tree, which some of you are aware looks approximately like this with lines in between and so on and so forth. There's a rough approximation. That represented another system. And then once we got past that, she implied that this entire thing was somehow encompassed by, what do you call it? An hourglass. And I kept thinking we were at final integration. And then I find some other parts. This person had an eagle-eye husband who was watching for certain things that we found to be reliable indicators. And so often I would get evidence of dissociation within a few days that would be subtly picked up. And what we found was I continued to find evidence of dissociation. And I'd find parts, and finally this part, as I kind of got angry with him and said, why when I give these idiomotor inquiries am I getting lied to? And this part said, because you don't understand. You're going to get us all killed. And we started talking. And then she basically said, it's been programmed so that if you succeed and think you've succeeded, you will fail. They build it in as a way to laugh at you. That if you ever get us integrated, we will die. And here's what she said. This part said, I'm one of 12 disciples, and I found this in others. 12 disciples within this hourglass, each of whom had to memorize a disciple lesson, which were basic satanic kind of premises and philosophies of life. Like, be good to those who hurt you. Hate those who are nice to you. On and on and on. There may be two or three sentences like that associated with each. They'd had to memorize them. And they said, we are like grains of sand falling. And when the last grain of sand falls, there's death. I said, is death a part? Yes. When the last grain of sand falls, the sleeping giant awakens. Sleeping giant was death, who was then to kill them on day one or day six after awakening, unless certain things were followed, and we did some of those. Well, we also found death had a sister as a backup, used with mirrors to create the sister part. We had to get past and deal with that too. And then we found, and by the way, death had certain things that they said had to be done for them to integrate. And I started to say, oh, come on. They lied to you before. And she said, wait a minute. This is what they said you'd say. They said that no doctor would ever believe that they had to go to these extremes to get us well. And that's why part of the reason they'd fail. I said, well, tell me again. She said, I have to be dressed all in red. I have to have Demerol on board. I've taken Demerol. I have to, a code has to be given, and it has to be in a room that's totally dark. It has to happen on day one or day six, after this part's been awakened. I said, what do I got to lose? Had a psychiatrist give her a little Demerol. We used the code. My office didn't have any windows anyway. It was pretty easy. Oh, and there had to be a couple, three or four, I think, candles lit. Well, fine. So we did it, and everything went well. Maybe it would have gone well if we hadn't done it, but I decided not to take a chance and to trust the patient, maybe. Well, so we go on, and then we find another part. There's death and destruction. another backup, also with a sister, that we had to get through. I think there were two backups there. And interestingly, the very last part was an extremely nice part, made especially that way so that they wouldn't want to lose them, because they would be so adorable and so loving and so sweet that they wouldn't want to maybe get rid of them. And then we found that she continued to have these feelings with this last part left now of darkness and blackness inside. And what did we find? A curtain. She said they assumed that if you ever got to this point, you would, and along the way, by the way, we had encountered the stuff about the LSD stuff, the Greenbaum programming. And the message was that, she said, there is a curtain behind which are the remaining feelings and memories. But it can't be opened from the middle. It's like a stage curtain. It has to be opened this way. But it can't be opened. They assumed that you would deal with all the, try and deal with all the feelings. That can't be opened until you've dealt with that last part and they've integrated. And so far it looks like we've got integration that's holding. So I found death and destruction and the hourglass in non-bloodline. The tree and the hourglass, this patient informed me, were made of sand because we were meant to die. We're expendable. We're the unchosen generation. I've heard variously that it's crystals or blood that fill the hourglass in bloodline people. And by the way, you can do real simple things like turn the hourglass on its side so nothing can fall out. So time stands still to be able to do certain kinds of work. Spread the grains of sand on the seashore so that they can't be numbered. And the time will not be counted. Got that idea from a ritual abuse victim who had seen some of this kind of programming done, but another therapist was seeing. So those are maybe just a few other hints about things that may be helpful and meaningful. We're talking about very intensive kinds of things. And at deep levels, to me, this gives us two things. One thing it gives to me is hope, because it gets the material and makes progress like nothing else we've ever seen with these people who haven't. The second thing it does for me is it demoralizes me too. Because I thought 3 years ago I had a pretty good idea about the extent and breadth of what they've done to these victims. I had no real appreciation for the depth and breadth and intensity of what they've done. And I want to come back to the other question over here now. Amount, but they're clearly not well yet.